Hi guys, this is 82nd QASTM Zoominar, and today our speaker is Evgeny Skvortsov from Mons, and he's going to speak about quantum higher spin gravity and three-dimensional bosonization duality, which is his part of the work, and he's doing from long time this kind of work. And thank you, Evgeny, for giving this talk and accepting to give this talk in our forum. And I believe we can able to learn a lot of things from you, and it will be really helpful for students as well. So you can start.
Yeah, okay. Stanton, many thanks for invitation. Well, whenever you need me. So my talk is about an attempt to construct some viable models of quantum gravity. And this approach is called higher spin gravity or higher spin theories. And I'll talk about, I'll give you a general review of everything in this context. And we'll also talk about my results and also some attempts to tackle three-dimensional bosonization duality through this higher spin gravity approach. But let me start with some main messages and maybe spoiler, or as well as plan of my talk, explaining you basic ideas in case something happens with internet connection or whatever. So as far as I understood, the talks are somehow 2 hours plus indefinite amount of time, something like this, which reminds me a bit of Russian seminars, which are also 2 hours plus questions. But in Russian seminars, the speaker doesn't have to talk for 2 hours because the point of Russian seminar is, for audience to explain the speaker what he did wrong.
Just given the time to give the freedom to the speaker. Whenever you want, you can stop.
Yes, okay. Yeah, let's see how much time it can take. Yeah, so as I was saying, I mean, the point of Russian seminar is to explain to the speaker what did he do wrong and why the whole thing doesn't make any sense. So I've sat through some Russian seminars where the speaker was only allowed to say hello because somebody already spotted some mistake in this statement. And then, let's see what kind of seminar this is. I need maybe 1.5 hours to cover everything I wanted, and depending on the number of questions, let's see how long it can take. So the main idea of this approach, which is called higher spin gravity, is to construct the most minimal extension of gravity with massless higher spin fields. By saying higher spin, I mean with spin greater than 2. So gravity has spin 2. And this idea is, it came to existence as an idea of constructing toy models of quantum gravity, or maybe not toy, but models of quantum gravity. And how it is supposed to work. So the idea is that whenever you have massless fields, you have some gauge symmetry behind. And if you have higher spin fields, then this gauge symmetry is bigger, in some sense is bigger than the one you have, say, for Young-Mills or gravity. And in fact, in higher spin theories, most of them, you have infinitely many fields, we spin from 0 to infinity. So there is some infinite dimensional gauge symmetry behind. And the idea is that the more gauge symmetries you have, the better, because the more gauge symmetry you have, the less counter terms you have. And if you simply have no relevant counter terms, then you have a model of quantum gravity. And in principle, you don't even have to compute anything, I mean, at the quantum level. But the same idea as the idea behind supergravities, that you have more symmetries and then quantum behavior improves. However, there is no free lunch here because higher spin gravities are very hard to construct due to many no-go theorems, which I will review briefly. So what we recently did, we constructed an example of higher spin gravity with massless propagating fields, which we call chiral, and some quantum computations in this theory were done. And they show that it is UV finite up to some order. So in flat space, this theory is closely related to self-dual Young Mills and QCD, and reproduces some of the amplitudes in these theories.
So like you talked about the massless, but why not massive? I can understand this is breaking the gauge symmetry, but why not that kind of thing is allowed?
Well, just you want to proceed in steps, because if you have massless fields, there is gauge symmetry and it already fixes a lot for you. But if you have massive fields, say with higher spin fields, like string theory, and you start bottom up, so you don't know what your theory is, you just try to bring some fields together and see what kind of interaction they can have, then the study of massive fields is much more complicated than those of massless. And in fact, for the cases we are aware of, all massive fields can be obtained via spontaneous breaking in some theories with massless fields that are coupled to matter. So in a sense, you always see that massless fields are, in some sense, more important than massive. But yes, we just can't do everything at a time. There is one example, I will mention it at the end, where we managed to construct a theory with massive higher spin fields, but it was obtained from some theory with massless, so which is much easier to study. So your question is absolutely legitimate, and I think we just didn't have enough time, and the study of massless fields is simpler than of their massive cousins.
Okay.
So we hope to do something about it in future. But so far, most of the studies are about massless fields. Okay, so in flat space, this theory is somehow related to self-dual Young Mills and QCD, while in anti-de-Sitter space, it's related, of course, thanks to Eddy's CFT correspondence, to some models of physics, to some three-dimensional conformal field theories, vector models, more generally, Chern-Simons meta theories, and Ising model is just one of those. And this theory helps to prove the three-dimensional bosonization conjecture at the level of three-point function. And there are many of these dualities that were discovered recently in three-dimensional conformal field theories. And we believe that, some of them, they rely secretly on higher spin symmetries. Okay, so this is more or less the plan. So I'll give general overview of what we're doing in the context of higher spin gravities, like no-go theorems, Eddy's CFT correspondence, some toy models. And then for two other parts, I will be talking about the theory that we constructed recently. And if time permits and we are not too tired, then I will review some other quantum tests of higher spin gravities. Okay, so why higher spins, which is also related to your question? So, the point of this slide is to put various spins on just one slide, because there are plenty of communities that can study theories with, say, one specific spin for decades. For example, in the condensed matter, you have plenty of models of second order phase transitions that are built of scalars, and scalar is spin zero here. These are not fundamental fields, but anyway, they are good QFTs and CFTs, conformal field theories. So you can be studying that just for entire life. So the only fundamental particle of spin zero we are aware of is recently discovered Higgs boson. Then we have plenty of spin half particles, which are matter fields we are built from. And then there is some threshold, because starting from spin one, you can have gauge fields. And then something special happens. For example, let us take the simplest example of a massless gauge particle. We can take photon, just massless spin one particle. And we can take number of photons, n of them, and try to see if they can interact. Then, the solution of this problem is well known, that under certain assumptions, the only interacting theory with massless spin one particles are, is Yang-Mills theory. And then Yang-Mills theories are parameterized in some sense by Lie algebras. So suddenly from this problem of how spin one fields, of how photons can interact with each other, you arrive at the concept of Lie algebras, representations, you construct Yang-Mills theory and so on. Yes?
I just want to point one thing. Like in this list, I feel that there are two things. Like one is like one pseudo-scalar. So pseudo-scalar is one of the possibilities which maybe appear in this series. Another one is also the anion, which has a spin in between fermion and boson. So why this? Because these are like quite important contribution in condensed matter physics as well. So I'm just asking that why that shouldn't appear in this list.
Well, because it's a cartoon, it's the very first slide, and of course you can discuss even more possibilities. So more or less, these theories are towards theories of fundamental interactions. So the fields you're thinking about here are eventually, hopefully, are particles in our universe. So while condensed matter systems are about some, well, collective phenomena where certain things can be seen as well as having say fractional spin. So this slide is just a cartoon, and so you, I mean, don't take it too seriously in the sense that, of course, there are many gaps. And even when I talk about the results here, I mean, these are theorems that are proved under certain assumptions. So if you lack some of these assumptions, then there can be more possibilities. Okay. So it's just, to set up the stage and put at least some of different spins on one slide. So when we study...
Yes. That this is like 0, half, 1, 3 by 2, 2, 5 by 2, 3, 7 by 2. So the higher spin things you are talking about, it is also follow the same rule, like it increased by half only, or it may be any fractional number.
So in this case, there is a theorem that say if you live in four dimensions, then the classification of possible types of elementary particles is known in the sense that you can have massive and massless particles, and the only, well, essentially quantum characteristic, they have a spin which can be integer or half integer. So in this sense, yes, I'm in four dimensions and I'm just enumerating all possibilities and trying to point out certain differences between various spins, because we will see that small difference in spin lead to very drastic difference in the type of, in kind of physics that the corresponding fields describe. So, for example, you jump from spin half to spin one, you have gauge fields, Yang-Mills, Lie algebras. And the point I was going to make is that, if it hadn't been for mathematicians to discover Lie algebras, so physicists could have arrived easily at the same concept just by studying how massless spin one particles can interact with each other. So then just consistency of this interaction immediately leads to the concept of Lie algebras. So now if we jump, say, by one unit and come to gravity, so graviton is a massless particle with spin two, and we can ask in principle the same question. What happens if I try to bring several spin two particles and make them interact? So then the first difference with spin one case is that gravitons don't like color. They don't like interact with each other. It's so-called no color theorem for gravitons. So eventually you can explain this by the following reasoning, that graviton is a particle that eventually determines the geometry of space-time. So there has to be only one particle to do that. So the first discovery is that there cannot be theories with multiple gravitons. There are assumptions. So again, I mean, there are assumptions of these theorems which are not always satisfied. And then, of course, again, under certain assumptions, we know that there is a discover diffeomorphisms, Riemannian geometry, and so on. So, like we discovered in a sense Lie algebras while studying interactions of spin one particles. So then we can jump back by half of spin and ask the same question about spin three half, which are gravitinos. So can we make several gravitinos interact? And the result is that we cannot. But if we're smart enough to realize what the source of this problem is, and some people were smart enough, then the solution would be to add at least graviton to the spectrum of your theory, and maybe some particles with lower spins. And this is how you can get supergravities. So the lesson that supergravity teaches, well, at least within this slide, is that it may not be possible to construct interactions unless you come up with the right multiplet of particles. Okay, so then there is another threshold here. So once you jump above spin two and ask the same question about higher spin particles, then there is a number of results that one can easily obtain, and they were obtained decades ago. The first result is that, again, like for gravitino, there is no theory of self-interacting spin three or spin four or anything like that. It's quite easy to see that whenever you have at least one higher spin particle, you have to have all of them. It doesn't mean there is such a theory, but through studying consistency conditions on interactions, you arrive at this conclusion that if higher spin theories are to exist, then the minimal multiplet has to contain fields of every spin, basically. And so this is about higher spin gravities. And then there is a string theory whose spectrum is also full of higher spin particles, but those are massive. And we know, well, string theory spectrum mostly consists of massive higher spin particles. I mean, the usual spins are like of measure zero in some sense. And we know that these higher spin states are crucial for consistency of string theory. So that's the idea of this slide, to show you what is the role played by different spins. And then again, not very rigorous argument, but various examples like string theory, whose spectrum is full of higher spins, divergences in supergravities, meaning that it's hard to come up with any solution of a quantum gravity problem while staying within a lower spin subset, like from spin zero to spin two, which are supergravities. They seem to always have some divergences. Of course, the case of n equal 8 supergravity is still open, but I don't think anyone believes it's free of divergences. So these ideas imply, I mean, they don't prove, but they imply that you may need higher spin states one way or another, massive or massless, in order to come up with manageable models of quantum gravity. And also another set of results comes through Eddie's safety correspondence, which I will review later a little bit. But here, if you take any sensible conformal field theory in dimension three or greater, then again, you easily find single trace operators with arbitrarily high spin. So if you believe that these CFTs are to have some quantum gravity duals in anti-de Sitter space, then sooner or later these theories will have higher spin states. Even though you may not see them in some regimes, eventually they will pop up. So the conclusions, not rigorous, from here are that perhaps you need infinitely many fields to construct a viable model of quantum gravity. And perhaps you need higher spin fields and all of them. And what we try to do in higher spin gravity is to find the most minimalistic extension of gravity by massless higher spin fields. And then the idea I already briefly talked about is that vast gauge symmetry should render these models finite. And then the folklore somehow is that quantizing gravity via higher spin gravity should be more or less equivalent to constructing at least an example of a classical higher spin gravity. Because in some sense, the masslessness of higher spin fields can model some of UV effects. So many of the problems that you face only at the quantum level, they somehow re-emerge already at the classical level in higher spin gravities. This is why it's hard to construct such theories, because they already probe something about quantum gravity. But these are, these are some vague ideas. And in a bit more detail, and I don't have too many technical slides in this presentation, but in a bit more details.
We know that there are few supergravity theories where like constructing the action or the Lagrangian is a little bit problematic, but do the construction for arbitrary spin particles, suppose massless. Is there a similar kind of problem arises in this His-Gra formalism?
Yes and no. Yes, in the sense that there are very few theories for which you know action. But this you can think is just technical problem. You guys did not work hard enough. But I think for supergravities, you find some problems with that, with constructing actions whenever you have some self-dual p-forms, because irrespective of supergravity embedding, these fields themselves have some problems with covariant description, with Lagrangian description. So you either should give up on covariants or introduce some complicated auxiliary fields which may enter nonlinear. So in this sense, whenever you have the same fields in higher spin gravity context, of course you'll face the same problem. But I think our problem comes even earlier, that we have very few examples of higher spin gravities for which we know actions. And this is due to the fact that, what we're trying to do is to construct simple models of quantum gravity. And through masslessness of higher spin fields, some of these eventually quantum problems we already face at the classical level. That's why it's hard. Yes and no.
Okay.
So if you have some time in the evening and you would like to help us, then let me say a few words about technically what the problem is. So we all know that massless spin 1 can be described by gauge potential a mu with gauge symmetry, and then spin 2 can be described by symmetric rank 2 tensor again with this gauge symmetry. So you just add one index to your gauge parameter. So you should not be too surprised to know that if you need to describe a massless spin S field, you need to take a totally symmetric rank S tensor and postulate this type of gauge symmetry, where nabla is just because you may be interested in different space-time, flat space, de Sitter, anti-de Sitter, maybe something else. So that's why nabla. But you can start just in flat space where things are deceptively simple. So this problem was formulated by many people, notably by Fronsdell many years ago. And the problem is to take free action, which exists, and it's a kind of d-phi squared action where indices are contracted in some way, but it's a normal action, like for scalar field, Maxwell, or Fierz-Pauli action. So the problem is to take this type of an action and introduce some interactions, some nonlinearities. Maybe In doing that, you have to deform your gauge symmetries, like it happens for spin 1, Young-Mills, and spin 2, gravity. So that's the problem, to construct an example of such a theory. And then whenever you have it, it would be nice to try to prove it's UV finite and hence a quantum gravity model. First of all, brute force doesn't seem to work because, as I explained, most of these theories have to contain infinitely many fields. So you can't just put this problem onto Mathematica and ask, write the most general ansatz and fix coefficients, because the most general ansatz would contain infinitely many terms. So something a bit more.
Now, Bartol.
Yes. It's not a question. I think somebody just forgot to mute himself. Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. So brute force doesn't seem to work, with one exception only. Okay, so how else you could think, you can start thinking about higher spin fields. So this is from nowhere. So you can just ask yourself, what are possible types of particles? Okay, they have spin. So let me just study possible interactions of fields with any spin. Then you arrive naturally at the problem of higher spin gravities. Once you already solved a problem with the Young-Mills supergravity, gravity, and so on. So another context where actually higher spins immediately emerge is eddy safety correspondence. So we have a duality between quantum gravity theories in entity sitter space and conformal field theories. And if you fully trust eddy safety correspondence, then more or less any reasonable conformal field theory should have a gravitational dual, which thereby is a consistent model of quantum gravity on an entity sitter space. And then once you believe in that, you can ask, what about the simplest conformal field theories, which are just free theories? So you can take, for example, free super Young-Mills theory. It's a nice conformal field theory still, even though it's free. Or you can discuss just a free scalar or free fermion conformal field theories. So these are theories from the first page of any textbook on quantum field theory. So it's very easy to see that these theories have infinitely many of higher spin currents. So you can just take your fields, sandwich a number of derivatives in between them and make it into a conserved tensor. And then a stress tensor is just one particular member of this family. Nothing special about it at the moment. So once you have a conformal field theory, and there are infinitely many of conserved higher spin tensors, which are single trace operators. So you can ask what it is dual to, because the canonical dictionary is that single trace operators are dual to some fundamental fields in the bulk. And in free conformal field theories, we have infinitely many higher spin currents. So again, according to canonical dictionary, if you have a conserved current or tensor on the safety side, it has to be dual to a gauge field on entity sitter side. So for example, just spin one current is dual to spin one gauge field. If you have a stress tensor, so two indices here, it's dual to graviton. And likewise, if you have a rank S conserved tensor, it has to be dual to a gauge, hence massless field in entity sitter space. And then what you can say immediately about such theories, even without trying to construct them. So one thing is that even though conformal field theory is free or can be free, so right now I just come up with this simple example where you can face higher spin fields. So even though conformal field theory can be free, these operators, or higher spin currents, they are composite operators. So these are not elementary fields, so these are some bilinears. And hence, correlation functions of these composite operators don't vanish. So for example, connected three-point function in your favorite free CFT, free scalar, free fermion CFT, it doesn't vanish. You can compute it by simple weak contraction, which is an exercise again from the maybe first chapter of any QFT textbook. So you have this one loop diagram, but if you're in position space, you immediately write down the answer because you just replace every pair of five with propagator, and propagator is one over X to some power. So you immediately have your answer. So however, because these correlation functions are not free, well, are not zero, they don't vanish, there has to be some interaction in the bulk to explain that. This is what this picture indicate. So we have this higher spin currents on the boundary where our safety lives. Three-point function doesn't vanish. And if there is some bulk theory to explain that, then there has to be some cubic interaction in this theory. And since all correlation functions of higher spin currents don't vanish, perhaps you have a highly interacting theory which contains massless fields of all spins. So gravity duals of even free conformal field theories are highly interacting theories. And the spectrum of those theories have to contain massless higher spin fields. So immediately, if you extend Eddie's CFT from the most canonical example, where you have strongly coupled superyoung meals versus string theory, to basically a general statement about relation between conformal field theories and quantum gravities, then you should start thinking about higher spin gravities as simplest models of this kind. Because, well, the spectrum of free conformal field theories is rather simple. So maybe you can learn something. However, there's a first warning here, because weakly coupled or free conformal field theories don't have large gaps. So they don't have gap in dimensions of operators. Therefore, on general grounds, you don't expect well-defined semi-classical local gravitational dual to these theories. So I think the first people who tried to invert Eddie's CFT correspondence and basically ask the question of how my CFT should look like for it to have a well-defined gravitational dual with these people. And one of the crucial assumptions in their paper was to have large gap. And free conformal field theories are weakly coupled in general, they don't have large gap. So some of the techniques explained there, they immediately fail. So this is one of the problems to start thinking about. Yes.
Your statements that you have given, it is not basically true for any particular dimension. So my question is how things are different in very lower dimensional CFTs and the bulk theories with the higher dimensional CFTs and the bulk theories.
This is a good question. So everything looks pretty homogeneous starting from three-dimensional conformal field theories. So which means four-dimensional bulk, because it is in this situation higher spin fields do have propagating degrees of freedom. So you actually studying fields. If you go to lower dimensions like Eddie's 3 CFT2, then even gravity in three dimensions doesn't have any propagating degrees of freedom. So instead of studying gravity, you study certain topological things or asymptotic, well, these boundary gravitons and so on. And then, there is at least one example, very recent one, by the way. So I refer to papers by Gabriel Gopakumar and Eberhardt, where they managed to understand the tensionless limit of string theory. And this is right on the next slide, so I better not to mention this. So right now, so if you go to even lower dimensions, like Eddie's 2 CFT1, then again, kind of SYK related context, you can start thinking about free conformal field theories there, and then basically there are almost no papers on these, so it's hard to say what's going on. But I think one way or another, these problems reemerge even in lower dimensions. But on the next slide, I'll try to argue what may be different in a string theory context. So my conclusion here is that this basic problem that I mentioned, it's true in all dimensions, but you can immediately see it starting from edges 4 and higher. While in lower dimensions, you need to work a bit more to see the actual problem. And sometimes there is some resolution, but it goes way beyond high spin gravity context. So I will mention this on the next slide.
Yeah, particularly I have asked the question because these days, this ADS2 CFT1 is going very hype. Like a lot of people are working because of this SYK, the black hole connection. So that's why I have asked actually.
Yeah. So you can have models. So in particular, my friends Alkalaev and Becker, they have two papers on that. So they considered some kind of free CFT in one dimension and the corresponding dual in Eddies 2, which has higher spin gauge fields in it. But of course, it's a bit topological. But I think there are only two papers on that, so it's too early to say anything. But indeed, it's a promising direction as well.
Okay, thank you.
So let's come to the most canonical example of Eddies CFT correspondence, where on one side here we have an equal four super and Mills theory, and here we have strings on Eddies 5 S 5. So let's have a look at this diagram for super and Mills theory, where we have two dimensionless coupling constant, which is convenient to choose as 1 over n, and Hooft coupling. So whenever n is large, so we actually here, we have planar limit, where many nice results we obtain all the way from weak to strong coupling thanks to integrability. So I make this planar limit, which is measure 0, 1 dimensional, bit more visible on this slide. So whenever a coupling is small or even zero, so you have weakly coupled or free super and Mills theory, which you have no problems computing anything in principle. You can trust your perturbation theory if it's weakly coupled, and you don't have to compute anything if it's free, in the sense that any computation would be very easy. So let's jump to string theory. Well, in string theory, we have three dimensionful parameters. Planck lengths, string lengths, which is a typical size of a string, and Eddies radius. So we can form two dimensionless cross ratios. And there are several regimes that is interesting to study. First of all, we assume that Planck length is much, much smaller than anything else. So we can trust our so we can think about quasi-classical gravity approximation. So then whenever your string length is much smaller than Eddies radius, then your strings, they sort of shrink, they become almost point-like, and then you can easily argue that only massless modes should survive so that you actually have a supergravity approximation instead of full string theory. So you're in this corner. So now you can change the ratio between string lengths and Eddies radius and move to the left, which corresponds to increasing string lengths, and at some point it exceeds Eddies radius, and somewhere here you start to have very long strings that wind all over empty de Sitter space. So it's hard to say what's going on. So this limit is called tensionless limit, because effectively tension goes to zero or to very small value, and your strings can do whatever they want. So this limit is counterintuitive, because it's hard to say what's going on. It's even hard to argue that in this regime, as different from this one, there can be any effective description in terms of field theory. But now, if we jump back to CFT side, then we can easily see what this limit corresponds to, because on CFT side, we have weakly coupled or at the extreme, a free super and Mills theory. And in free super and Mills theory, as in any other free theory, you can easily find infinitely many of higher spin currents, from which you can argue that this tensionless limit of string theory should be full of massless higher spin fields. But there are also other states, many other states, which play the role of matter. And there are not so many cases where this picture was understood. So some recent work that I already mentioned by Gabardil, Gopakumar, and Eberhard concerned with Eddies 3 background, where from my point of view, higher spin fields don't have propagating degrees of freedom. So these are systems that are a bit different from what I want. But in any case, it's an amazing result that you can make what tensionless limit of string theory means precise on both sides of this duality. And there was a recent paper by Gabardil and Gopakumar dealing with ADS5 CFT4, but it was maybe just a few weeks ago, so let us give it some time. And I should mention various people who come up with these ideas. So the first was Sandborg, then crucial simplification was found out by Klebanov, Polyakov, and Sezgin Sandel, who realized that you don't have to work with full string theory and super and mu. So let us just look for simpler and smaller conformal field theories, like free conformal field theories and vector models, as different from super and mu, which is kind of matrix model. So where this duality looks simpler, and this is what I'm going to review in a few slides as well. And there were some other papers on that. So there are several contexts that I mentioned how we can start thinking about higher spin fields just for fun, because a spin is a immanent characteristic of a particle. Because of ADS CFT in general, whenever your CFT is weakly coupled to free, your bulk theory has to have massless higher spin fields. And from string theory and empty de Sitter background, again, if you like to study this diagram in full detail, then you would like to move to the left, which is quite easy to do on CFT side. And here you find tensionless limit, which you would like to understand. And again, from ADS CFT type argument, this limit will contain massless higher spin particles. So these are various contexts where higher spin particles can appear. And now I'll describe some problems of why it's not that easy to construct such theories. So I'll be talking implicitly about higher spin symmetry, because once you have infinitely many of massless, that means gauge particles, there is some symmetry behind. I didn't quite describe what the symmetry is as a symmetry, as an algebra. So, but you can think about these higher spin conserved tensors, and stress tensor is a part of this family, as the Noether theorem corresponding to some symmetry on your in your CFT. And this is the symmetry I'm going to talk about. So, and then there are various situations that you can find if you have symmetry. If your symmetry is too small, then probably not, it's not really helpful. Nothing can be computed even with a theory. Well, don't take these arguments too seriously. So if you have, if your symmetry is too big, then everything is fixed even without a theory, just from symmetry. So higher spin symmetry is a kind of intermediate situation. Almost everything is fixed and there are very few theories that actually can be consistent with such huge symmetry. And the first, maybe one of the first person who argued that higher spin theories must not exist, at least in the S matrix context, was Weinberg. He did this through his low energy theorem. So the problem here is to think about some reasonable quantum field theory with an S matrix that whose spectrum contains usual particles with some spins and masses, and assume that there is also a massless spinless particle, and see if it imposes any constraints on S matrix itself. And remarkably, there are such constraints, and these constraints are insensitive to details of this S matrix. So this blob that I have here representing S matrix where you have massive fields on external legs completely factors out of this theorem. And what you find instead are constraints of this type. So here I have sum over momenta of these external particles, which is weighted by the coupling constant with which they can couple to a massless spin S particle. So S enters via the number of momenta here. All indices are free, and that's crucial. And also the details of interaction enter via this coupling constant. And then there are several situations. for spin one, you see there is S minus one. So for spin one, you simply find that sum of all coupling constant must vanish. And in this context, coupling constant is usually called electric charge. And we are totally happy with the fact that electric charge is conserved. And now it's a consequence of Lorentz invariance of S matrix. For spin two, you have one power of momenta here. And the sum is weighted by a coupling constant between matter and spin two. If you don't want to trivialize your scattering, because you see this is a constraint on your momenta to have non-trivial scattering. So if you don't want to trivialize your scattering by restricting the momenta of incoming and outgoing particles, then you'd better make all coupling constants equal to each other so that it factors out, and what you find is momentum conservation, which is anyway there. So through this argument, you discover that all matter should couple universally, which means with the same strengths, to gravity. Again, as a consequence of Lorentz invariance of S matrix. Okay, now something bad happens. Because if spin is greater than two, you simply have too many conservation laws. So you have this polynomial in momenta, and even if you make all coupling constants equal, it doesn't help. You have too many constraints, which basically tell you that scattering has to be trivial. So the theory has to be free, non-interacting. So this is the first argument, which is, I think, 50 or even more than 50 years old. And of course, it prevented many people from working on higher spin gravities, and rightfully prevented, but there are some ways out as well. So the conclusion from here would be is that, well, maybe massless higher spin don't exist at all. At least they are not observed in asymptotic state. So they, for example, can confine so that you don't see them in S matrix. Okay, let's see what else. There are, of course, other no-go theorems like Kalman modulo, which constrains symmetry of S matrix. And it is basically the same that whenever you have symmetries which carry non-trivial representation of Lorentz algebra in high spin, do you have too many constraints on S matrix? And as a result, we have this quote from quite recent and very good textbook by Matthew Schwartz, who says that an interesting and profound result is that it's impossible to have interacting theory of massless particles with spin greater than two. The required gauge invariance would be so restrictive that nothing could survive it. We will prove this in the next chapter. Okay, so this is basically the result of Weinberg low energy theorem. And we will see to which extent this statement is true. However, so what we discussed so far, modern spinner helicity language, they didn't use that, but it doesn't change the result. So if you set helicities here to be equal to plus one, minus one, you get amplitude from Yang-Mills theory. If it's a plus two, minus two, this corresponds to amplitude from Einstein-Hilbert action. And you see that formula doesn't discriminate higher spin particles whatsoever. So it's quite homogeneous in spin. And then the puzzle, not an immediate contradiction, but the puzzle would be, so why you have all these cubic amplitudes for possible helicities, but don't seem to have theories that take advantage of those? A bit uncomfortable, right? So, but of course, that's life, and there may not exist any higher spin gravities. Or there are very few higher spin gravities, but interactions are fine-tuned in such a way that eventually you do get a trivial S matrix in Minkowski space. But then there are other backgrounds, for example, anti-de Sitter space, where you don't have to have trivial scattering. So we'll see what's the conclusion, at least today, is. And these two slides were about constraints from higher spin symmetries on local physics or physics at infinity in flat space. Now, what about anti-de Sitter space? So let's try to study exactly the same problem that Weinberg studied, but in an anti de Sitter space, at asymptotic infinity of anti de Sitter space. And like he did, we try to impose gauge invariance on S matrix, which in this context is known as holographic S matrix, and see what happens. We already know from Eddie's CFT dictionary, which helps, that asymptotic states in some sense would correspond to conserved higher spin tensors. And we also know that free CFTs give you plenty of examples with conserved higher spin tensors. However, you can prove the opposite statement. So given any CFT in dimension three or greater with stress tensor and at least one higher spin current, you can prove that this CFT is free. So this arrow is going both directions. So if you find CFT with a higher spin current, then it must be free CFT in the sense that all correlation functions of these higher spin currents are expressed, correspond to those of some free CFT. It can be free fermion, free boson, or something else, but it's always free. And let me know that this essentially proves the duality, no matter how higher spin gravity in anti de Sitter space is realized, it may not even exist. So if it exists, your boundary conditions somehow preserve higher spin symmetry, then the first people to get this result in three dimensions were Maldasen and Zhiboyedov. Then we extended it to any dimension, and there are some other related papers. So whenever you have higher spin gravity and your boundary conditions preserve higher spin symmetry, you don't have to compute S matrix in some sense, because you already know it has to be given by free CFT. But of course, this doesn't prove that these theories exist. You can touch them. But you can see that this is kind of generalization of Weinberg and Kolmogorov-Mandula theorem to Eddie's CFT, in the sense that if you have a higher spin symmetry at the boundary of anti de Sitter space, then holographic S matrix has to be given by free CFT, which is kind of analog of S equal one in Eddie's CFT context, because I mean, free CFTs are very simple. So holographic S matrix is simple as well. But there is another side of this story, which is available in anti de Sitter space, but it's not available in flat space. Because in anti de Sitter space, you can impose different boundary conditions. In particular, you can play with Neumann-Dirichlet and impose some mixed boundary conditions. So in particular, they don't have to preserve higher spin symmetry. So you can play the game that is known as slightly broken higher spin symmetry. So when your higher spin tensors are not conserved, but their non-conservation has a very special form here. And an example, which is absolutely relevant for physics of this situation, is Ising model. Or to make some of this argument rigorous, you'd better take Largen limit of Ising model. But even for Ising model, certain statements here are true. So let's take this Largen critical vector model or Wilson-Fisher or Ising. So it's just phi to the fourth theory at the critical point in three dimensions. So if n is large or infinite large, then this theory does have conserved higher spin tensors. But whenever you depart from n equal infinity point, higher spin tensors are not conserved anymore. However, their non-conservation is a small effect proportional to 1 over n. And what's even more important is that operators that stay on the right-hand side and determine non-conservation of higher spin currents are constructed in some sense from higher spin currents themselves, which closes the loop in the logic, because if there were some other operators that we have no idea of, then this non-conservation equation is not useful. But because the operators that determine non-conservation are built from higher spin currents themselves, you can actually take advantage of this non-conservation. And you can fix some, or if not all, correlation functions, and they will be those of the large critical vector model in this case. And this type of an argument can be extended to more general situation, which are known as Trans-Simons meta theories. So I'll be talking about them in the last part, and how we can take advantage of higher spin gravities for the benefit of Chern-Simons meta theories and dualities therein. But here conclusion is that if you impose different boundary conditions in your higher spin gravity, then holographic asymmetrics is given by large and Ising model, which is not that useless. There is last Eddie Sifty related argument that was made possible by these people, Becker and Mergen, Ponomarev slide, and then later by Tarona slide. So they tried to play the game of inverting Eddie Sifty correspondence, because what people used to do is to take theory in entity de Sitter space, compute correlation functions, and compare those with CFT correlation functions. But let's do the opposite. Let's take CFT that we already like and manufacture a theory in entity de Sitter space that computes exactly these correlation functions. So we reconstruct this theory, which solves two problems for us. It gives us a theory in entity de Sitter space, and it gives us a theory that is dual already by construction to the CFT we started with. So just kinematically, Eddie CFT is a triviality in the sense that the amount of independent structures on CFT side and on Eddie side are exactly the same. So you can always write some ansatz for your interaction in entity de Sitter space and adjust coefficients in such a way that it will give you any meaningful correlation function on CFT side. So let's play this game and start from free CFT. So we have just d phi squared action. There are higher spin currents, which are bilinear in the scalar fields. We can easily compute correlation functions by weak contractions. And what these people did, they reconstructed an interaction vertex in entity de Sitter space that computes exactly these three-point functions. So now you should proceed to four-point function. And again, this is easy to compute. And there is a piece of it that you know from the bulk. You can glue your cubic vertices together, which we fixed at the first step. So you compute these exchange diagrams. And if they already give you what you want, you're done at this order. If they don't, you have to add some quartic interaction so that the entire thing matches your correlation function. But it turns out, if you do the computation, that sum of exchange diagrams does give you the right structure, but it gives you with a wrong coefficient 2, so you overshoot. From this, it immediately follows that you have to add quartic interaction, and it also follows that your quartic interaction has to be a multiple of exchange diagram. So it has to be highly non-local expression. So basically you have to add to your action something that we usually consider to be quantum contribution, but you should add it to your classical action. And most of the things we know about field theory, they fail to be true once you have non-localities of this type in your action. So field theory doesn't like that, which again is a kind of problem that I already mentioned, that there is no since there is no large gap, so it's hard to construct the dual. But these people, they quantify the problem that you have by actually constructing the quartic interaction with higher spin gravity and showing that it's a highly non-local beast. And basically the problem in this context is to tame these non-localities. So let me summarize consequences of higher spin symmetry, both in flat space and entity de Sitter space. So if you just study basically free gauge symmetries, but at infinity of flat or entity de Sitter space, then you come up with following conclusions: that in flat space, there seems to be only one solution, trivial scattering. I put stars here because there is counterexample that I will talk about, it does give you one eventually, but not from the very beginning. So if you're in entity sitter space, then depending on which boundary conditions you imposed, you can have several cases. So if your asymptotic symmetry preserves a full amount of higher spin symmetry, then holographic S matrix has to be given by some free safety. However, if it doesn't preserve, if it breaks higher spin symmetry, but in a clever way, then you have a range of holographic S matrices, which are supposed to be given by vector models in general Chern-Simons meta theories. And then there are maybe two conclusions you can make. The first one is that, say, even if you have the most trivial S matrix whatsoever, it can actually help you to understand your quantum gravity model better, like in this context. Your bulk theory is still highly interacting, but what it computes from safety side are free safety correlation functions. We of course know everything about those, so this part is not very useful, but maybe you can invert everything and understand better the quantum gravity part. But of course, there is no free lunch again, because as I mentioned, duals of free or weakly coupled conformal field theories are highly non-local. So there is something to think about. And there is the second part, that you can have interesting duals where we still don't know many things, like we don't know correlation functions even in the large end limit, and there are interesting dualities in this Chern-Simons meta theories, but I'll have some slides about that. Okay, so after this general introduction into the problem, it would be interesting to see, I hope, the list of higher spin gravities that I actually survived, in the sense that they are as close to field theory as you can only be with higher spins, and they are not obstructed by any of the problems that I already mentioned. So I have two slides. One is for theories that are actually almost field theories, or because in three dimensions, we know that gravity can be understood as Chern-Simons theory with gauge group SL2 plus SL2, with gauge algebra SL2 plus SL2. So if you, the idea, which is very simple, is that if you take a Lie algebra that is bigger than SL2, which is basically any Lie algebra, then and write the same action, then when you decompose it into components, you'll find tensors with many indices, which are reminiscent of higher spin fields. And there are also interesting dualities that people discussed in this context. There is also another class of theories in the same spirit, 3D conformal higher spin gravities, because again, conformal gravity in three dimensions can be formulated as Chern-Simons theory, but now of SO3,2. And if you find some higher spin extension of that, you'll have conformal higher spin fields in three dimensions. So, okay, these all examples don't have propagating degrees of freedom. So, because everything is Chern-Simons. So now, what about theories that have propagating degrees of freedom? So one nice class of theories are so-called four-dimensional conformal higher spin gravities, which are extensions not of Einstein-Hilbert action, but of Weyl gravity action. So your action is Weyl tensor squared, and then there are some higher spin contributions with more indices. And so the reason why everything goes through here is that these fields are not strictly massless, they're conformal. Also, these theories are immediately non-unitary because, well, Weyl gravity is also non-unitary, it has a high derivative kinetic term here. But what's good about this theory, apart from relation to conformal geometry, is that Weyl symmetry, local Weyl symmetry that is present here, tames all non-localities. So this theory is perturbatively local, very nice. So everyone is welcome to study it. And then there is a theory that we constructed recently, the chiral theory, that I'll have some slides on that, so no details at this moment. So one way or another, these theories avoid no-Gauss theorems. Surprisingly, and this is related to your question, Sayantan, about action, surprisingly, all of them have simple actions, which, well, some of them already written here, but some of them takes maybe one, two lines to formulate and explain. So they are also as close to field theory as only possible. And now there are other ideas which are not quite yet there, but still are very useful. So one idea is I already reviewed a bit, which you can call reconstruction, in the sense that you attempt to invert eddy CFT correspondence. And well, so you take your favorite CFT, better be free CFT, just to be simple, and try to reconstruct the dual theory from correlation functions. Then you can just follow brute force method, and this was pushed up to four point functions. Then there is a clever change of variables under path integral proposed by Jivicki, Melakoch, and collaborators. And also there is a very recent paper by Aaroni and Pals trying to push this approach even further. So the the good point here is that you start from your CFT, from the full partition function, and then we have some change of variable, you try to rewrite it as a theory in empty de Sitter space. And then the problem is, so you're guaranteed to have all answers from CFT by default. But the problem maybe is that the further you go from CFT, the more subtleties you find. So in particular, there are some strange non-localities, higher derivatives already at the free level. But let's give it some time. Then there's also holographic RG, but there are very few papers on that. There's another class of models which are higher spin extensions of IKKET matrix model. And here, I won't be giving you any details, but here the idea is that you have some non-commutativity already in space-time. And this is perhaps how we can avoid some of these no-go theorems. Then, of course, there is the oldest maybe approach that I'll call formal higher spin gravity, which was initiated by Vasiliev many, well, 30-something years ago. And if you formulate it in modern terms, this is about constructing L infinity extension of a given higher spin algebra. Again, I'm not going into mathematical details, just a few words to review this activity because I'm also working on it. So this is about constructing some L infinity extension, which means that you have some super manifold and an odd nilpotent vector field on it. And then once you have such a vector field, you can write some sigma model. And okay, if your L infinity has something to do with higher spin symmetries, then this equation should have something to do with higher spin gravities. And in fact, we solved this problem in full generality. So if you give me any higher spin algebra, I can easily write down equations of this type, and some new examples were constructed. But the main problem, which was discovered in 2015, was that L infinity algebras are very, very far from field theories. So this has nothing to do with higher spins whatsoever. You will find the same problems if you try to formulate usual theories in this language. And the problem is that you find some non-localities, some meaningless infinities all over the place, unless you fine-tune your L infinity structure maps in a very specific way. But now, so this is true for everything. Forget about higher spin fields. But what's special for higher spin fields is that, given all these non-localities that we're already aware of, it's at present, it's impossible to do that. So what we discovered in 2015 is that Vasiliev equations, well, basically most of interactions there lead to meaningless infinities. And well, at least at present, it's hard to resolve this issue because we already know that theories are more non-local than field theories can be. So you need somehow go beyond field theory approach. So the conclusion here is that certain things do work. In particular, there is a lot of beautiful mathematics here that is related to L infinity algebras and deformation quantization, but it's also very far from field theory approach. So we will see. Let's give it some time more. Okay, so finally, I come to what I want to talk about. Higher spin gravity and three-dimensional dualities. So the idea here that I would like to briefly explain is that we work in the light cone gauge. So light cone gauge is ugly. So I'm not going to show you any of the formulas. It's ugly and we just need to accept it, but you can get used to it. And eventually it's very useful because in the light cone gauge, which is unitary gauge, you deal only with physical degrees of freedom. So this is a kind of gauge that is suitable for building up theories because you avoid many of the problems that are related to one or another covariant description. So for example, coming back to your question on the supergravities and the self-dual p-forms, of course, there are no problems in the light cone gauge with the self-dual p-forms whatsoever. So there are some features of covariant descriptions that would be nice to avoid, especially if you don't know what your theory is and you would like to construct it or prove that it doesn't exist. And many important results were first obtained in the light cone gauge, like quantization of strings or finiteness of n equal 4 supernormals. And only later people come up with the covariant proofs. So what you need to do here is to construct directly generators of your space-time symmetry algebra. So if you're in flat space, these are generators of Poincaré algebra. Momentum, angular momentum, all of them. But it happens so that most of them, they don't feel any interaction. So you need to care only about very few commutators here. And for example, these are exactly the commutators that fix critical dimension and intercept of string theory. And we construct same operators, but in the situation we need, which means higher spins. And in four dimensions, you don't need these symmetric tensors because, they have many components. Most of them are redundant. So if you go to the light cone gauge, then we know that any massless field in four dimensions has only two propagating degrees of freedom. So basically, this tensor is equivalent to just two scalars representing helicity plus minus S states. Okay, very good. And just to give you a manageable example, let's talk a little bit about Young-Mills and self-dual Young-Mills, because the model we construct is a kind of higher spin extension of self-dual Young-Mills. So let's take Young-Mills theory. So we have gauge potential A mu and impose light cone gauge. So we impose A plus equals zero, then we solve for A minus as a function of everything else. And as a result, we are left only with two fields, which I called phi plus and phi minus here. And then the complete action of super Young-Mills theory has this form. There is a canonical kinetic term. Then your cubic vertex splits into two pieces, and that's important. And then there is also quartic vertex. So this is full super Young-Mills. So now let's just erase these two terms, half of the cubic and full quartic. So what you're left with is a self-dual Young-Mills theory. And it has very nice properties, which we will also see realized in chiral higher spin gravity. So first of all, if you compute tree-level amplitudes, they all vanish. However, so you can say that at the classical level, your theory is trivial. So S matrix is one, exactly like Weinberg ordered for higher spin fields. So if you compute one loop amplitudes, they don't vanish, but are simple rational functions. And what's important, they coincide with all plus helicity amplitudes of pure QCD at one loop. So you can say that self-dual Young-Mills theory as a field theory is unphysical because once you drop this, you lose. We also did some computations to check the quantum properties of this theory. So if you compute all tree-level amplitudes, which is possible, even though you have infinitely many fields in this theory, you see that all three level amplitudes vanish on shell. So on shell amplitude vanish in this theory. So now we can jump to loops. And first remark is that the higher the spin in your interaction, the more derivatives we can have. So, the number of derivatives is basically sum of the helicities. So the theory we have is naively non-renormalizable by power counting because you just have too many derivatives in your interactions. But there is a kind of miracle that is similar to the one in N equal 4 supremum mills, where you can easily see that theory is renormalizable, but with the help of supersymmetry, you can see that one moment eventually factors out of your loop integrant and you have a convergent expression. So we have the same miracle, but amplified infinitely many times, because what we could prove to one loop is that there are no UV divergences. Somehow they all go away. And if you compute all one loop amplitudes in this theory, what you see is this. So you have three factors. One factor represents just all plus helicity amplitudes in QCD at one loop. So, okay, it's maybe a strange way to compute some amplitudes in QCD. Then there is some kinematical higher spin dressing factor just to account for helicities on external legs. And then there is a factor which you can find, or similar one, you can eventually find in any theory with infinitely many fields. So this has nothing to do with higher spin peculiarities. Just take any theory like Kaluza-Klein reduction of something that has infinitely many fields. Sooner or later, if you compute loop diagrams, you will have to give some prescription on how to sum over the spectrum. Yeah, but here the factor is very simple. It just counts basically the degrees of freedom that we have. And as Weinberg ordered, or well, ask us, you'd better set this factor to zero so that you're consistent with Weinberg theorem. In any case, if you have infinitely many fields, you have to prescribe some values to these sums, and then it would be really nice if you could prescribe value zero to this sum. And this counting there's a trick that was explained by Beccari and Zeitlin how to naturally think about this sum as being zero. So let's take this sum of 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1. And well, there are similar sums you can find in string theory. And in string theory, we are used to zeta function regularizations. So let's try to play the same game. So we have in this sum 1 degree of freedom per scalar field. And then every massless spinning field contributes 2 degrees of freedom. And we have infinitely many of them. So let's regularize this sum with zeta function. Then this equals minus 1/2, so you get 0. But it looks just a funny trick, but there are some reasons to do that, even if you didn't know about Weinberg theorem. Okay, so the summary of this part, chiral higher spin gravity in flat space, is that you have a theory whose spectrum consists of all spins, or at least of even ones. You can also add some Young-Mills gaugings in a way that is reminiscent of string theory, so-called chain pattern factors. For example, you can't have something like E8 chiral higher spin gravity, so the gaugings have to come in these with these groups. So we have to deal with spin sums, which are nicely taken care of by Wallschmidt in string theory, because it would be a nightmare to decompose the spectrum of string theory into individual states and try to sum up over them. But here, somehow, the spectrum is quite small, so we can actually do that, and zeta function helps. So the action also contains parts of Young-Mills gravity as we wanted. And what we see, and this is the crucial effect observed so far, is that yes, higher spin fields do soften amplitudes, but in this case, so there are no UV divergences. First of all, but moreover, you can actually make your S matrix trivial to please Weinberg and his low energy theory. But before you do that, it also gives you all plus amplitudes in QCD and self-Dilovian means. But of course, Minkowski background is not the only one for higher spin gravity. So if we can jump to something else like anti-de Sitter, then some of these drawbacks, like eventually trivial S matrix, will no longer be there. And you can easily do that with the help of a recent paper by Metsaev, who extended light cone approach to anti-de Sitter. In anti-de Sitter space, light cone gauge is even more ugly. So there are some vertices here that I'm not going to give, but the structure is the same. In particular, you have this funny gamma function sum of helicities. So you don't have any non-localities, so you avoid all no-go theorems that I mentioned. So now flat space results should guarantee the absence of UV divergences in anti-de Sitter space. So it should be a consistent quantum gravity toy model there. And now if you compute a holographic correlation function, so I computed three-point functions, which is a very easy thing to do in light cone gauge, they don't vanish. They are not trivial and they don't belong to any free conformal field theories. So you do have an untrivial theory in anti-de Sitter space with higher spin fields. And now let's try to apply this theory to something that is, well, belongs to Earth. To be precise, to interesting models of second order phase transitions, which are at the same time conformal field theories in three dimensions. And conformal field theories I'll be talking about, they also incorporate, well, famous Ising model and its extension to vector models. For example, there is this a liquid helium phase transition, which is a second order phase transition, and it's described by n equal two vector model. And there is extension to theories which are called Chern-Simons meta theories, all the way up to Evgeny theories. But I will consider only the four simplest examples of this kind. So let us take first of all. So we are in three dimensions. So let's take the two simplest CFTs we can think of, a free boson, well, free scalar CFT, and free fermion. So there are interacting extensions of these theories where you add quartic self-interaction, and at conformal point, this is exactly Ising or Wilson Fisher, and this one is called Gross-Neveu. Now what I'm going to do is to take advantage of some luxury that is available only in three dimensions, namely Chern-Simons section. So I would like to gauge some of the global symmetries here. Well, we are standard covariant derivative and add Chern-Simons term to this. So as a result, I have four families of conformal field theories in three dimensions that describe physics still. Even if you add Chern-Simons interaction, there are some interesting relations to anions that Sintan already mentioned, but now they are of course not fundamental particles. Okay, because of Chern-Simons, they break parity in general, and they do depend on two parameters. One, which is the number of components here, n, and another one is Chern-Simons level k, but it's just useful to form analog of Tuft coupling here. So apart from being nice families of three-dimensional conformal field theories, what's nice about them is that they exhibit remarkable dualities. Well, many of them were discovered just recently by many people. Well, this is certainly an incomplete list here. And one of the dualities is a so-called three-dimensional bosonization duality. So let me explain what's that. So first of all, I just put four theories that I described with the Chern-Simons coupling turned off into the corners of this diagram. Now I turn on Chern-Simons coupling. And then if n is large, then this Tuft coupling is almost a continuous parameter. Let's think it's continuous. Then you have four continuous families emanating from each of these points on my diagram. And the conjecture is that if you start from Ising model, turn on your Chern-Simons coupling, then whenever you go to very large, infinitely large coupling, you end up at free fermion safety. And likewise, if you start from free fermion safety, turn on Chern-Simons coupling, and then in the strongly coupled limit, you arrived at the Ising model. So the conjecture is that these two families of conformal field theories represent just one conformal field theory. There are two different ways to describe the same physics. And now you see why it was called three-dimensional bosonization, because we are in three dimensions. And this theory is formulated in terms of bosonic matter, phi, and this theory is formulated in terms of fermionic matter, but the conjecture that they describe the same physics. And likewise here. There are some tests of this duality. In particular, we did some tests at the level of three-point functions and anomalous dimensions. So far everything works. But what I want to do is to apply this strange chiral higher spin gravity to these dualities. So first fact I need is that chiral theories are rigid. So you can't just throw in one more field or eliminate one field from the spectrum or change coupling constant. So everything is fixed in these theories. Also, these theories have the right spectrum to be dual to Chern-Simons meta theories, because you have all fields of all spins. And in Chern-Simons meta theories, you have higher spin currents of all spins. So it works nicely. They can't be dual because Chern-Simons theories are unitary, even though parity violating, and chiral theory is not. So chiral theory has to correspond to some subsector of full higher spin gravity that is dual to Chern-Simons meta theories. So at the free level, we have exactly the same spectrum that we need. Then at the level of cubic interactions, which means three-point functions, chiral and anti-chiral interactions cover all possible three-point interactions you can have. So you have a complete base. At the quartic level and further, it's not the case, but let's stick to the cubic level. So then if you want to fix, if you want to compute all three-point functions in theories like Chern-Simons meta theories, what you need to do is to learn how to glue chiral and anti-chiral pieces together, because each of them is like a brick. You can't decompose it into smaller ones, so you need to know how to glue them. And this is a very simple problem. What you find out is that there is one additional parameter that specifies this gluing of two blocks together. And this has something to do with electric magnetic duality transformation in anti-de-Sitter space. Now, bosonization is manifest. Why? Because bulk physics is insensitive to elementary constituents on safety side. So we don't know if our higher spin currents are built out of bosons or fermions. What we see are higher spin currents that are dual to higher spin fields in the bulk. So if you can prove from the bulk that correlation functions have to have this form, irrespective of anything, then it will immediately prove the bosonization duality at this order, because it doesn't matter if you take theory with fermions or bosons, or maybe you can come up with 10 more theories that have same properties. It doesn't matter, because correlation functions will be fixed essentially from higher spin symmetry. So if you do this exercise, so you do find exact form for all three-point functions. And there is an earlier important result by Maldoseno-Zhiboyedov that you should match them with. Because they found out, partially conjectured, that three-point functions in Chern-Simons meta theories should have this form. So what you see here are three-point functions of higher spin currents. So you have three times infinite set of correlation functions. And then just purely from conformal symmetry, without any details, you know that there are three independent structures that can show up. So usually people say that three-point functions are completely fixed. by conformal symmetry, this is not precisely true. They are fixed up to finite number of parameters. Well, once you fix spins, but if you don't fix spins, like here, the number of parameters is actually infinite. So one such structure comes from a free boson CFT, another one, and it is independent from the previous one, from free fermion, and there is another one that doesn't show up in any of the free theories, and it was a problem for some time to actually to find it, prove it's unique, give it give some specific formulas for this structure. Okay, so but if you take advantage of this slightly broken higher spin symmetry, the fact that currents are a bit not conserved, you can fix three-point functions, at least three-point functions, up to this one parameter that enters in a very nice trigonometric form. And this is exactly the structure that you obtain from chiral higher spin gravity. But now, you get more because you know all correlation functions, in particular, this odd piece in the three-point function is now fully known, even though in the light cone gauge. So which in fact makes first prediction coming from higher spin gravity that is ahead of CFT computations, because concrete computations in Chern-Simons method theories are very hard. Because in order to check duality, perturbation theory is not enough. You want to know your observables all the way from weak to strong coupling. So and this is hard. So in particular, three-point functions for like all spins have never been computed directly from Chern-Simons theory. So right now, chiral with the help of chiral higher spin gravity, we make prediction for these odd pieces, and in fact prove the entire formula just from the chiral higher spin gravity. And this approach has some chances to prove three-dimensional bosonization duality, provided we can extend it to high point functions. Okay, so just few general remarks, which are not about higher spin theories, but just pop up naturally once you work on these problems. So as I already pointed out, massless field in four dimensions is equivalent, I mean, has only 2 degrees of freedom that correspond to plus minus S helicity eigenstates. You shouldn't be surprised that if you are in three dimensions and have a conserved spin S tensor, then again, conservation law imposes so many constraints that secretly your conserved tensor can be expressed in terms of only two components, which again can be associated with helicity plus minus S states. And in general, there is a following useful relation. You can start from four-dimensional Minkowski space, which is easy, where you know, say, all three-point amplitudes. Again, I wrote them in spinor helicity notation. Then each of these vertices can be uplifted to a vertex in four-dimensional anti-de Sitter space. And through Eddie's CFT, each of these vertices correspond to some conformal structure in three-dimensional conformal field theories. So in fact, you have one-to-one correspondence between amplitudes in a flat space of spinning massless particles and three-point correlators of conserved tensors. So my point is that helicity can be a very useful concept, especially for three-dimensional conformal field theories. And there is some recent paper on that by Karen Hort and Lee. What else? So through this approach, we see slightly more conformally invariant structures that was previously found in manifestly covariant approaches. For example, in flat space, Young-Mills vertex splits into plus, plus, minus, and minus, minus, plus pieces. Each of these generates some contribution to three-point correlation functions. Then, of course, natural question to ask is what these chiral or anti-chiral theories dual to, because they are legitimate higher spin theories in anti-de Sitter space. And again, I believe that one can proof, like we did in flat space, that these are the only one perturbatively local theories. So unless you solve this non-locality problem, there is nothing else. So since these are legitimate higher spin theories, then useful question is, what are they dual to? So we don't know. There must be some fishnet type truncations of Chern-Simons matter theories. So it would be nice to study this problem. And also through this approach, one comes up with a different idea of how to bootstrap conformal field theories, which can be useful, especially in three dimensions. Because in the light cone gauge, what we do is we build up charges corresponding to our space-time symmetry algebra. And well, we can do this in flat space, but we can as well do this in empty De Sitter space, or we can forget about field theory and think about conformal field theories and play the same trick. So basically through Eddie's CFT correspondence and this chiral higher spin gravity, this is what I actually did. So we can construct these results, can be interpreted as constructing charges of conformal algebra in three dimensions directly in terms of physical degrees of freedom, which are in this case higher spin currents. But okay, here is my summary in picture, in terms of pictures, for chiral higher spin gravity in flat and in empty De Sitter space. So in flat space, everything looks trivial. So you have a theory that is not free in the sense that there is no field redefinition that makes it look like a free theory. Nevertheless, three amplitudes vanish. One loop amplitudes reveal this remarkable cancellation of ultraviolet infinities. And when you compute them, they have this piece of QCD and some funny factor here, which if you just prescribe it to be zero, then S matrix is one, it's trivial. Or if you jump to empty De Sitter space, then there are some curvature effects which are mild, but they change your S matrix from something trivial corresponding to free CFT to something non-trivial. But you expect the same basic properties to be true, that there are no UV divergences in this theory. And S matrix, holographic S matrix of chiral higher spin gravity gives you some subset of correlation functions in Chern-Simons meta theories. And we can also show that this theory is the smallest higher spin extension of graviton. So, let me give some summary. And by the way, check the time because I've been talking for almost 2 hours. So let me make my conclusion and don't even jump to this other quantum computations. So what I hope I convinced you about is that there are some higher spin gravities, for example, chiral, conformal, and all these examples in three dimensions. So chiral theory reveals trivial matrix in flat space if you regularize things properly, but not in empty De Sitter space. If you think about applications of higher spin gravity in general, then there are two maybe useful approaches that I have nothing to say about, but other people are thinking in this direction. First is about cosmology, because it may be, and it should be, I guess, that in at early times, universe was dominated by something else, just pure Einstein action. And in higher spins, we do need absolutely some high derivative corrections. In particular, on top of Einstein-Hilbert term, you have to have some R cube term with a very specific coefficient. And maybe one day something like this can be observed, but in any case, you can study these applications, hoping that in some future, something will be observed. So another application would be to black hole physics and so on, because in some of these models that are manageable and written down explicitly, you can look for black hole solutions. And in fact, people study this case a lot in three dimensions where everything looks like Chern-Simons. So you can try to understand these paradoxes and puzzles of black holes through higher spin gravities. Okay, so then this model that I like to talk about is chiral higher spin gravity. It's a toy model with some stringy features in the sense that you have infinite spectrum. And it shows you in principle how gravity can be quantized thanks to higher spin fields, because you do see that higher spin fields are important for canceling UV divergences. And well, in some sense, higher spin symmetry plays the role of supersymmetry in this context. And it looks like even more powerful, which is not always to your benefit, because it can fix too many things that you would otherwise prefer to be free. But at least as far as UV divergences are concerned, it helps. Well, okay, just as an application, not to be on purely mathematical physics side, we computed all three-point functions in Trans-Simons meta theories, making some new predictions for those that haven't been computed from CFT side. And this also proves bosonization duality at the level of three-point functions in the large N limit. There are two other solutions that chiral higher spin gravity gives you, and it would be nice to find what are they dual to. Well, there's interesting relation to self-dualian mills and QCD that I hope should be explored further. And yes, coming to what we talked on the first slide, what about massive higher spin fields? So the only theory with massive higher spin fields we are aware of is string theory, but we managed to construct another example, which is derivative of this chiral higher spin gravity. You can simply compactify it to three dimensions. And this way you get a theory with massive higher spin fields, and its spectrum is much, much smaller than that of string theory. And because of this UV cancellations of higher spin gravity, this theory also can have nice properties at UV. And I think this is pretty much everything we can say about theories with the massive higher spin fields, like bottom up, like trying to construct them. So, okay, I think I'd better stop here. So, and thank you for your attention. There are some other slides on these quantum corrections and so on, but I think since I've already been talking for almost 2 hours and these slides are quite technical, let me go back. Yeah, where it is. So let me just say a few words. Did I start sharing? Zoom, then share screen, start now. Okay. Yes, we are back. So what I wanted to say is that you can do some tests in theories that we don't understand. So like these holographic higher spin theories, which are abstracted, or at least are more complicated due to non-localities, but still we can compute certain things at the quantum level in these theories. And so far everything works. So I think I don't go into the second part and just stop here. So thank you for your attention once again. And if you have questions, so I'm done.
So thank you for your nice contribution. If anybody have any question, please ask.
Hi, Professor Skvortsov. I'm Abhinash.
Hello.
Hi. I have very basic. I mean, like queries. These are not questions, probably. So I want to know, like, do we expect any experimental proofs in latter half of the century or something? Like, till now we haven't found any experimental proof, right? Like, do we expect some particles to be observed?
Okay. So there can be two ideas. Well, maybe even more ideas about experiments. So first of all, just historically, I don't think anyone seriously thought at the beginning that any of this will ever lead to any observable effects. It was just curiosity, how to construct viable models of quantum gravity. But I think at the moment we have well, variety of ideas, starting from quite solid that, well, yes, it will, to more vague. So talking about more solid things, through Eddie's CFT correspondence, higher spin gravities are related to three-dimensional conformal field theories that do describe physics. Of course, as always, it happens with Eddie's CFT, we are in the Lagrangian limit, while actual physics like magnets or boiling water or liquid helium, they correspond to smaller n. But of course, well, the whole idea of Lagrangian emerged from thinking about QCD, where n is 3, and then 1/3 has to be a rather small number. So in this sense, there are good chances to, well, 100% chances to apply higher spin gravities and higher spin symmetries in general to study second order phase transitions and dualities between three-dimensional conformal field theories. Then talking about like less solid applications, of course, it would be hard to observe any massless higher spin particle. But from what I already said, you can see the following, that if you do some kind of collider experiment, so you're more or less in flat space, then of course you can't see higher spin particles in your S matrix. But if you're at a very large distance, so that cosmological scale plays a role, like in this chiral higher spin gravity in empty de Sitter space, then S matrix becomes non-trivial. But I mean, I'm not saying that you should build a cosmological collider in this sense, but you can have some observable signatures of higher spin particles from cosmology. And there are actually quite few papers on that. So if you manage to measure some non-Gaussianities and other things in future, and there are experiments planned to do that, yes, why not? Because higher spin gravities predict specific high derivative corrections to gravity, so it's not completely unthinkable. I try to stay more on this condensed matter side, where you do have solid applications.
Okay, thank you. Then I have another question to ask. This higher spin gravity theory, so we expect this to generalize to low spin theories, low spin particles, basically. So is that possible in this case? Basically, can we generalize higher spin gravity theories to like to the theory of fermions or bosons of our integer spin, or I mean, half spin, half or spin one?
Okay. So yes, generalizations with say supersymmetry or fermionic particles are possible. So I just didn't talk about that. So usually supersymmetry plays no role in higher spin gravity, in the sense that higher spin symmetry should be already good enough or powerful enough to guarantee you everything. But just for free, almost for free, you can always introduce fermionic particles. So the usual bosonic spectrum is that you have all fields from zero to infinity. So in particular, you have scalar, fundamental scalar, well, maybe dilaton, you have your graviton, and well, other higher spin stuff. But if you supersymmetrize this theory, you do have spin half, spin three half. So no problem here. And of course, maybe eventually you want to break the symmetries in some way, so that everything becomes massive and so on. And then it's like this kind of what people try to do in string theory, in the sense that you don't see all these stringy massive higher spin modes, of course, in the real world. You only see a small subset of that. But I can't think of any concrete papers towards that. Yes. Okay. But fermions you can easily have. Yes, thank you.
Fine, thanks. I don't have a proper knowledge about higher spin gravity. So if I want to learn about higher spin gravity, where do you suggest me to start? Basically, is there a good review paper or a book or something? Can you suggest one? Obviously, in your talk, there are so many papers that you mentioned.
Yeah. So there's an unfortunate situation here, because there are quite good old reviews, in particular iCosert one, but these reviews don't touch anything of what I actually talked about.
Send it to me, the reference. I will pass it to him.
Yeah, okay. But what I'm trying to say, well, I actually want to write a review that would cover all these recent developments. But unfortunately, at the moment, there is none. In particular, there are theories like this conformal higher spin gravity on which there are no reviews at all. There are only research papers, so they immediately jump to technicalities. So I tried to, there was something in Wikipedia, if I remember. I don't know who wrote that, but there was something in Wikipedia that you can start with. But if you wait a couple of months, I hope to finish a review that covers exactly all of this and something else. So unfortunately, all this information is scattered over many research papers.
Okay. Thank you.
Anybody have any other question, please? If not, then please give a clap for him for giving such a nice talk. And so thank you, Eugene, for giving this nice talk. And this talk will be posted in YouTube. And once this is posted, I will share the link. Okay.
Okay, many thanks. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so now I suggest the other people, because I am stop recording right now.
Okay. Now,